Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 13th, I hope that's not ominous, meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to consider whether we take agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you very much. The first evidence session that we've got this morning is with regard to the Audit Scotland audit of NHS Highland. And I want to say, first of all, welcome to Rhoda Grant, who joins us online for both this session and the second session this morning. But I also want to welcome, via video link, our three witnesses from NHS Highland, who are Pamela Dudek, who's the Chief Executive. Good morning, Pamela. Boyd Robertson, who's the Chair of the Board of NHS Highland, and David Garden, who is the Director of Finance for NHS Highland. If I could begin by reminding everybody, the committee included, that we are very tight for time this morning, so I would appreciate short questions and short but incisive answers. But to begin with, I would like to invite Pamela to make an opening statement. Pamela.
Thank you, Chair. It's actually our chairman that's going to do the opening statement. But good morning to everyone.
Mr. Robertson. Martin Va. Good morning from Inverness. Thank you for the invitation to meet with the committee to discuss the NHS Highland 2021 annual accounts and the Section 22 report. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the extraordinary efforts of our health and care teams, our managers, our patients and our council colleagues for the magnificent way in which they have responded to the manifold challenges of the pandemic. The commitment, professionalism, empathy and compassion our teams have shown during the past 2 years has been truly remarkable and impressive. I would like to place on record my sincere thanks and admiration for the work they have done and continue to do. I took over as Chair of the Board just a year before the pandemic struck, and Pam Dudek, who took up the Chief Executive post in October 2020, has yet to experience a period free of COVID in her role. Despite leading the organisation in such highly unusual and demanding circumstances, I am pleased to report that NHS Highland has made huge progress in addressing the issues that led to the Board's escalation to level 4 on the Scottish Government's ladder of escalation. That is acknowledged in the Section 22 report, and it is further recognised by the Board's de-escalation to level 3 last year. The organisation has made major advances in addressing a transformation agenda which covered culture, finance, performance, governance and leadership. Board governance has been greatly enhanced through measures such as the strengthening of the Board Assurance Framework, a revised committee structure, the bi-monthly integrated performance and quality report. The leadership of the organisation has been radically revamped, both in terms of the executive and non-executive arms, and we now have a very strong board in place. Many positive actions have been taken to improve the culture of the organisation in the close on 3 years since publication of the Sturrock report. These measures have included the establishment of a culture oversight group, the appointment of an independent external advisor, a listening and learning staff survey and panel, a leadership training programme, and the establishment of new employee services like the Guardian Service and the Employee Assistance Programme. One of the most significant initiatives has been the healing process, which was co-produced by whistleblowers, staff side and our HR team. The second major challenge we faced was our financial performance in the years up to 2018, when a sizeable financial deficit had accumulated, resulting in the need for a brokerage from the Scottish Government. A three-year recovery programme was put in place in 2019, aimed at bringing the Board's finances into balance. Significant headway has been made in tackling the original deficit. Much of that can be ascribed to the work of the Programme Management Office, which has been embedded to direct and to drive cost improvement opportunities. A number of revised financial governance arrangements, including the formation of a financial recovery board, have also been contributory factors. By the end of the financial year 1920, we had fully achieved our substantial savings targets, with 56% being made on a recurrent basis. Our year-end outturn exceeded our financial plan, and our brokerage requirement was lower than the approved target. We plan to deliver a similar financial performance with reduced brokerage in 2020-21 until the pandemic intervened and severely impacted our ability to enact the full savings programme. Nevertheless, we still managed to achieve significant levels of savings when other boards struggled to do so. The financial turnaround, which has continued in 2021-2022, has been a tremendous achievement and is the result of a huge amount of hard work and endeavour by our clinical and management teams, our finance staff, and our programme management office. I can say with confidence that NHS Highland is now in a much stronger position than it was, and that is well equipped to deal with whatever challenges lie ahead. Our Chief Executive, Pam Dudek, and our Finance Director, David Garden, will join me in answering questions.
Thank you, Mr. Robertson, for that opening statement. That sets the scene very well, I think, for the areas of questioning that we have got. Pam Dudek is the Chief Executive and therefore the Accountable Officer, so my intention will be to direct questions to Ms. Dudek, but she may then in turn defer them to Mr. Garden or yourself, Mr. Robertson. You touched there on the financial position of NHS Highland, which is one of the reasons why a Section 22 report was required in the first place. And I think there were three consecutive years where the in-year financial balance was in the red. And you've highlighted, Mr. Robertson, in that opening statement, the extent to which savings are required. And I think the order, as I read it from the Audit Scotland report, is £32.9 million worth of savings. I guess my opening question is to ask about the progress that's been made. You know, where are things now financially with NHS Highland? Do you consider yourselves to be on course to make the cost improvements and the savings that you've identified? And how have things been affected by COVID? So, Pam Dudek, I'll address that to you first of all.
Thank you very much. As you'll appreciate, it's a very volatile environment in which to manage the finances. And I think, to our credit, we have kept our PMO going right through the pandemic, and actually the interaction with that, in spite of the pressures, has been significant. As you'll see, and as you recognise, that you know, has interrupted what was a very clear and worked out programme of savings over the last 3 years, and therefore we have had challenges in fully achieving the intent. In the here and now, that kind of volatile environment remains a challenge for us and will continue, like other boards, as we go forward. But I do believe we have a very strong methodology, and we have significant buy-in across our organisation. And I guess the culture aspect of this is also important, because it's been a bit of a mixed message over the last year and a half in terms of dealing with the pandemic, additional funds coming in, so a contradictory discussion with our teams in terms of you need to spend to deal with the pandemic, but you need to save to help our underlying deficit and get us to the right place. So we have a fair degree of confidence in terms of being able to make significant savings, and have already you know, had started the process for the year to come, but we have a lot of work to do to be successful in that, and like other boards, believe we will be challenged in that space, and Dave could come in and talk a bit more about that, if that's helpful.
Yes, Mr. Garden, please come in.
Thank you, and good morning, everybody. Absolutely, as Pam said, the challenges we've faced in the last two financial years as a result of the pandemic have meant that, like other boards, we've not been able to deliver the level of savings needed to break even without financial contributions from the Scottish Government. And the £32 million that was mentioned as our targets for the year just closed, we fell short by about £12 million in delivering those savings. But you know, that sounds really, really negative, when in fact we delivered during a pandemic £20 million worth of savings at a time when people were really busy dealing with other more important things. So we need to celebrate the fact that we still did deliver those benefits, that we have processes in place that allow us to continue to do that. But we need to recognise as well that it's been a really, really difficult couple of years in terms of delivering savings. And moving into next year, or the new year we're in now, Ireland, like most boards in Scotland, are facing a fairly significant financial challenge.
Thank you. I suppose one of the questions in and amongst talk of savings and cost improvement programmes is what effect that is having on the level of patient care, and what effect that's having on the services that you deliver. You know, is there an adverse reaction in order to achieve those challenging targets, Pam Dudek, that you mentioned?
So, to date, I guess as a really important part of the cost improvement work, one of the stages is to quality assure the decision making and to look at the impact of that decision and that proposal for savings on care and treatment. So we have got a safeguard in there that sends checks that, and to date, I haven't come across anything that's given me significant concern in terms of the decisions that have been taken, because we have that safeguard in there. I guess the looking forward, the real challenge is that obviously we obviously have to balance our books, and we have to have good governance around that, but we really have also to consider the reform agenda in this. It isn't going to be possible to just keep slicing savings, and that's what we've been trying to do, really think about the change and innovation that helps us balance our books but doesn't compromise quality of care. And that is really, I suppose, from my perspective, the key focus that we have to maintain and build on if we're going to be successful and not bring about that compromise. But we have challenges out with the finances, if you like, in terms of maintaining the level of care and treatment that we would wish to, and that relates to workforce.
Right, thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to ask Colin Beattie to come in, because he's got a series of questions he wants to put to you. Colin.
Thank you, Peter. Mainly it's about governance and succession, which have in the past been serious issues with NHS Highland. So just for the beginning, what progress have you made in your first round of succession plans? My understanding was that your first meeting on that would take place in December 2021. Pamela?
Board established. However, in, as you'll be aware, the last few months from December have become pretty hot in the system, so our ability to really formalise that has been compromised somewhat, and we have set a further target of October around that. But what I would say is all of last year we spent a lot of time looking at our management structures, looking at the kind of succession and the challenges that we had, as you say, from what's gone before. And we've actually had quite a successful year in terms of bringing in new people from different parts of the country and securing some of our really important posts and actually had really good attraction to these posts, so good fields to choose from, which is clearly really important. Where we're at the moment is really trying to pin down the appraisal process, the personal development plans, in those first three layers of leadership and management. So I'm talking about managers and clinical leaders and the succession framework that will take these people into the right space to be fit to lead for the future, which requires a different set of skills from perhaps what's traditionally gone. But we're definitely seeing more interest in our posts, and we have managed to successfully bring in people with really good credentials to see very senior posts, and we'll build on that now. And we've also introduced a leadership and management course that will run through the top four layers of management and leadership, again, with that whole succession planning in mind.
Just moving on that, what actions have the board taken to address the findings from the Sturrock report and to foster an organisational culture that's much more open?
Yeah, so I could probably spend, I know they've got to be succinct, I could spend a lot of time talking about this because we've done a huge amount of work in this space, and we have reported that regularly into our board in the public session, and there are many papers written on all the actions that have been taken forward. And we have that's also very much connected into the culture programme that was established and therefore consolidated the actions required of the board into one programme of work. We have taken forward the culture survey that was asked in terms of Argyll and Bute, and we have brought in an external guardian service who have been with us now. This will be them into their coming up to their end of their second and will be going into their third year with us, which was the contract. And that has definitely given people a safe place to go and raise concerns, many of which are resolved on the first contact, and those that require further action that are either raised with management or the guardian service indeed will provide a further service into a team or with an individual. We also have implemented our whistleblowing standards, and that relates very much to this agenda in that our whistleblowing champion goes out and is visible and visits and makes his visits. They're advertised so that, again, there is another confidential and private way for people to come forward if they can't raise it within the organisation. Now, as you opened, you know, with the statement, how do we have an open and transparent and an organisation where people can feel free to speak up? Well, that comes down again to myself, the tone that I set, the management and leadership of the organisation. And I have worked hard with my executive team and middle management to reinforce the style and approaches and encouragement that we should have for people to speak up and share their ideas. And I guess it's a people organisation, so it always becomes very challenging in that space to get things to 100% bulletproof. So I will say that it's work in progress and will continue.
Briefly, could you indicate where you believe the healing process is at this point on the back of these what you've been saying?
Yeah, so the healing process is just, we're just concluding the healing process. So 271 people have gone through that process and been supported through psychological therapies, a payment or an apology bespoke from myself, and as well as other actions that come out from the interaction they have with the independent panel. So we're just concluding that now. And the healing process has also generated learning reports. So a consolidation of the learning and the themes, and again, that relates back to Sturrock, it relates back to our culture programme. Are we addressing all the issues that are being raised, both historically and in the here and now?
And just if you could briefly indicate what actions the board's taking, this maybe for you or for a chair, what actions the board's taking to review and refine the board risk assurance framework?
I think Boyd's looking to come in, but I'm happy to hand to him or continue.
Absolutely, if Boyd wants to come in and talk on that one.
I just want to go back to the previous question about the board, the strengthening of the board and of the executive arm. We appointed 7 new executives in the year in question and have a further tranche of 15 senior management appointments in the year just ended. So that's one indication of the way in which we've strengthened our operation. We've also strengthened the board as well. We've had 4 appointments of non-execs in the year in question, and a further one last year. And we co-opted a member to the audit committee with particular skills last year, and we're extending his role on the committee in answer to points that were raised previously by your committee. In terms of the Sturrock report, 31 of the 35 recommendations in the Sturrock report have been enacted already, and Pam has referred to a number of the actions that have been taken. We've got a very important 4-level leadership and management development programme, and we have also courageous conversations, which have been training, package which has been delivered to over 1,000 colleagues within the organisation, which is a very significant number. In terms of the risk assessment, that is being comes under the aegis of the audit committee, which itself has been strengthened, and our internal audit arm has created a programme of inquiry into aspects of how we handle risk, and we've taken several steps to improve our risk assurance framework. And I'm going to ask Pam to say a little bit more about the precise steps.
In terms of our risk framework, we have done a huge amount of work in that space. But it's fair to say we still, as a board, want to do a bit more. So we have got a framework in place, and we are working around how we state our risk appetite and tolerance in the months to come. And that kind of will become much clearer as our strategy emerges, because we're working on our longer term strategy at the moment. We have a very clear risk register now, and a much better rhythm around how that's reported and set out to go through our board committees and indeed be added to if there's anything from the board committees that needs to be added in. And that is reported up to our board meeting, as you would expect. We've also, within that framework, got an assurance level that's reported both at committee and at board, and that relates to risk, and so being able to draw assurance and justify the assurance level, which is on a 4-level framework, from substantial to not being able to draw assurance, that is based on how we manage risk. So I think we've come on significantly from when I joined the organisation, but I think it's fair to say that this is something that is on an improvement journey, and we spend a lot of time refining and improving and understanding and looking at other good practice to try and get ourselves to the optimal space that we can get to.
And just one last question. Something that didn't really come up in this last report was Regmore Hospital. And over years now, it's appeared as a sort of a problem child, where costs were significantly higher in areas like prescriptions and, I think, consultants and so on. What progress has been made to reduce the costs in relation to Regmore?
Two kind of big areas, and you've mentioned one, which is prescribing, and the sort of kind of activity that has come through a cost improvement has been around looking at the high-cost drugs. And that's resulted in significant savings of 2.5 million in 3 years. The other one is locum costs. And actually, as you know, we've had hard to fill posts. We still have hard to fill posts. However, we brought our locum our decision making about locum arrangements in house and put a process around that. And that has resulted in a reduction in those costs. And Dave can give the figures in terms of the Raigmore spend. We are, though, also operating acute as a one hospital, four site arrangement so that we can optimise our rural generals. You're probably aware that our rural generals remain a real challenge for us in terms of staffing, and that leads to high locum costs in order to maintain the services there. And again, for me, that's a reform agenda to try and address that, and one that we're looking at quite significantly. So Raigmore has definitely, in the year of the Section 22, been in a more managed space, if you like, and will remain so. But I think, like any acute hospital, it will have ongoing challenges of increasing costs of new technologies, and our challenge will be to try and build that into our budget and to prioritise as appropriate. And again, the teams there are very bought into the cost improvement methodology, and we will, as I said before, be reinforcing and doing workshops with them to really get back on track now that things are feeling like they may be easing a bit.
Thank you very much. And following on very neatly from that are a couple of questions which the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, has got. Sharon.
Good morning. Yeah, to look at workforce challenges. Previous Section 22 reports have highlighted that NHS Highland needed to address its reliance on locum and agency staff in order to achieve long-term financial sustainability. COVID-19 pressures have increased the board's requirements for locum and supplementary staffing and delayed plans for the development of the attraction, recruitment and retention strategy. Nonetheless, the board has made progress in recruiting permanent medical staff and nursing staff, and it's filled 21 hard-to-fill consultant positions, including in rural general hospitals that you just mentioned there, as well as 62 newly qualified nurses and midwives. The board also took the management of locums back in-house in October 2020 to better control spending and rates. Can you tell us a bit more about what actions the board is taking to reduce reliance on locum staff?
So the recruitment strategy is key to this. As you'll understand, the kind of national picture is very much one of a competitive market and a reduced availability in terms of what we're looking for in many quarters. So we have done quite a bit of work on the recruitment side of things, and obviously we have a national treatment centre to deliver as well, which requires additional staffing. So there's a few different things. If I talk about our recruitment strategy, we are very actively working to be present in a full-on way in job fairs wherever we can. We have been looking at different ways to advertise and attract, and we are also looking at how we onboard and assist people to come to the region. And again, you'll be aware of the challenges of finding accommodation and getting settled, particularly actually more so since the pandemic began. So we're trying to look at all aspects of recruitment and to be very, very diligent and very enthusiastic about how we do our recruitment. And as I say, we have seen signs of that paying dividends. We've also been very careful to consider our expansion with the National Treatment Centre coming on and making that a people plan that's integrated, because there would be a real danger that we would undermine Raigmore by having these as two separate centres. So we've worked very hard with the clinicians and the teams there to have that as an integrated model. And I think for retention purposes, that gives a nice portfolio for people, that gives a bit of diversity, but it still keeps it a team game. So I guess we're looking at just about every different way that we can attract, involving communities to make to try and sell the areas, particularly when you get into your remote and rural areas. And as I say, having quite a bit of a marketing strategy, if you like, to recruitment and retention. Obviously, looking after the staff we've got is key to that. They have been through a tough time. But I'm always hugely impressed when I'm out and about at the level of commitment and enthusiasm and keenness to get to a stable place. So supporting the staff we have, but being fairly proactive in different ways to try and recruit new people. We've also engaged in the international recruitment side of things as part of the national approach, and we're exploring partnerships with on an ethical basis at the moment with other countries.
Okay, thank you. You've actually touched on the next question. You've kind of covered it. I was asking what the board was doing to attract, recruit and retain the workforce needed in NHS Highland. So another question that I would have is, have the processes that you've put in place been enough to encourage the people to stay in the positions? So we've obviously said that you'd recruited 21 hard-to-fill consultant positions and took on 62 newly qualified nurses. Have you managed to retain all them? One of the questions that I'd had in the previous session was, was the pandemic having an effect? So because of restrictions, people couldn't move about, so that was maybe having an effect of keeping staff. So now that restrictions have loosened, have you seen any change there?
Yeah, we have seen a bit of an increase in our turnover, and we're just at the moment trying to analyse and understand what is behind that. So it's not necessarily that those that have come in moving on. We also have a kind of demographic in our workforce that sees about 27% over the age of 55. And I do think that we have definitely come across people who have made the decision to either retire and return and do something part-time with us or retire completely and made life choices. Equally, we have seen people make the choice to come to Highland and move away from the cities and to come and work in this space for a better life. Work-life balance. But we are keeping a close eye on that. During the pandemic, as you say, it came down significantly for us, but it is on the increase again. So we are looking at that closely across all the different professions, and we're seeking to understand that and what we need to do to try and mitigate that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. I think Boyd Robertson wanted to come in, but we are pressed for time, so I'm going to go to Craig Hoy, and then if Mr. Robertson wants to come in after Craig Hoy's questions, I'll see if we've got time to do that. But Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Just in relation to retention, just wonder if you could briefly tell me what exit interviews you do. When somebody's leaving NHS Highland, what are they typically telling you they're leaving for? Why?
A very good question. This is an area that historically doesn't seem to have had the value placed on it that it might have, and we have had to pick that up and start to put in a process. So we haven't got a high degree of formal feedback, and that's what we want, what we're trying to implement. But the people I've spoken to, and it is anecdotal, we are trying to build up that data set so that we can be much clearer in that. It is varied. We definitely have people making choices because of the experience of the pandemic, and they're at an age where they can make that life choice. And so we definitely I've come across a number of people who have decided to go on that basis. The Retire to Return has offered us an opportunity there where we can try and negotiate some of these people still staying with us through vaccination programmes, etc. We have had I have had feedback that some people have left because of the historical arrangements and the difficulties that they've experienced, but those have been in isolated cases. So I think this is an area that we need to improve significantly on to have a much more robust database. So I'm sorry, but other than that, at the moment, I'm not able to give you really good, robust data, but we are in the process of implementing that framework.
Yeah, I think that is critical, and that appears to be common to other health boards as well. And I think if we have a recruitment and retention crisis, then I think capturing the reasons as to why people are leaving the profession is probably vital. Just in relation to the creation of a more sustainable workforce model, what efforts are you putting in to that? And the fact that you're competing all the time with other areas of Scotland, where perhaps they don't have the issue of rurality or cost of living, what more could the Scottish Government do to support you, and NHS Scotland could do, to support health boards like NHS Highland, who can't compete on an equal basis with other parts of the country?
So I suppose the areas that I've raised nationally have been around the I suppose, the support, particularly in that international recruitment space, just that we're at the start of that as a nation, and I think we need to try and see how we can make that go at a slightly faster pace and build it bigger, if you like. I don't see that as the cure for all, however, but I do see it as a really important thing. The other bit is really relates, I suppose, to that wider community planning partnership agenda and how we work much more diligently and firmly and connected in a connected way with our communities to support the economy and to provide careers for people and ways in which they can grow in that space and not perhaps have to leave their locality. So we are doing quite a bit of work in that space in the Highland Council area and in our Gael and Bute, although the Highland Council area we're probably a little bit further ahead, where we are investing with partners in strengthening that community planning approach. We've got 9 community planning groups, and that obviously the focus there is us as an anchor organisation really trying to create jobs. But you know, the benefit for us is that we get people local working for us, particularly in care and routes in through nursing, etc. So we see that as important as the international one. The other aspect nationally that I think is important is our particular difficulties are in relation to down the West Coast accommodation. So again, we've been working very well with our council colleagues in that space and the housing associations, but the level of stock available there that's affordable and permanent versus the pace at which we need to bring people in is challenging. So I think we've mobilised lots of actions in that area, but anything that could help us there. People have talked about a waiting, and that doesn't exist at the moment, but we certainly, you know, for our rural generals to thrive, for some of our islands to thrive, we have to have an offer that brings people in and supports them, both from a social and welfare perspective, as well as a professional portfolio that keeps them dynamic and motivated. So those are kind of some of the areas that are trickier for us. We can create the profiles, we can work with NES and the universities to try and get more local courses, etc. But anything that supports us in that space nationally, because you're right, we are competing with bigger boards where it may be more attractive from a portfolio perspective, or indeed it may be easier to join in those areas than it is for us, particularly around the West Coast. But I have to say Inverness is extremely challenging now as well, as it tends to be.
Thank you very much. Thanks,
Richard. Thank you. The next questions are going to come from Willie Coffey. Willie, over to you.
Thanks very much, convener, and Matinva to the panel in the Highlands. I wanted to just start by reminding everyone that occasionally at the Audit Committee, when a health board comes before us, it's usually as a result of Audit Scotland knocking on the door and the Scottish Parliament's committee also having a look at matters. And to your great credit, you appear to have turned things around financially. But what the question I always have here, Pamela, is how can there be such a transformation in terms of the finances and there to be no impact on healthcare or the public's perception of healthcare in NHS Highland? How has that come about? Would you say, you said yourself there was nothing of significant concern as a result. So how can that be, if you don't mind just answering that for me, please?
So the decisions that we've taken, you know, formally to make a saving go through a 5-stage process, and one of those stages before it's signed off and it's absolutely felt to be viable, if you like, is that our clinical director nursing, our medical director and other clinical leads will review that and will advise on the risks associated with it, and indeed I would say that we're looking for them to recommend and support and set out the risks so that that decision making can be taken collectively. I think our bigger risk than the finances in the last couple of years has been the workforce challenge, and the, you know, at times the deficit in nursing in particular. Also, some of our hard to fill consultant posts, such as psychiatry, will have felt precarious for the public, but that's not been a financial saving issue. That's been a workforce supply issue. So I think we do have the right diligence around what we're doing. I think looking forward again, that is a really tricky one, and why I'm really it's really important that we work with communities around this. We do have to change and reform to deliver services differently. That's not news, and we need to do that not just for financial reasons. We need to do that to be sustainable. And I think that the only way that we can do that is with our communities, so that we have a clear understanding and joint agreement about what's tolerable and what's not, and also so that we can escalate if we've been in a position where we think we have to make a really difficult decision that would compromise care. I'm told we'd never get there, but I think it is a discussion with the public and with our workforce, because we are used to very clear models of operating, and they are not going to they're not going to square the bottom line unless we can think of different ways of working.
I mean, do you engage directly with the public? I mean, if you say on the one hand, we used to spend all of this amount of money on delivering this care and we no longer do that, doesn't that have an impact? Or is it the way you're transforming it? Are you still able to deliver the same level and quality of care by this transformation process that you've embraced as a result of the Audit Scotland report and the Audit Committee's interest in the work that you do?
I think it's getting more difficult, and that's the reason that we're going to have to push further on that in terms of what does reform look like. We do engage with the public. We still could do that much, much better than we have done historically, and perhaps what we've done to date. We've engaged quite extensively, or I've tried to engage quite extensively with the public in terms of developing our new strategy, and we'll continue to do so. And as is often the case, unless there's a very specific thing, your kind of level of engagement is variable. But we are really going to try and improve on that, because I do think that shared understanding, but also communities come up with solutions. You just have to look at our experience through COVID of the mobilisation of communities to help us, and that strengths-based approach. And I still believe that's where a lot of our improvement and answers lie, working with communities so that things don't come as a surprise or feel like they're a downgrade, if you like, in services. And so we need to continue to try and do that well. And I still think we have a way to go with that. And I do think that if in order to retain quality, we have to have those really difficult conversations about how you change and retain that. But that has to be at the heart of everything we do. Our clinicians won't buy in anything else either.
And just lastly, are you confident, can you give the committee the assurance that looking ahead, you can continue to make the savings that you are making, and hopefully post-COVID, you can continue to deliver the quality and level of care that the public in NHS Highland expect?
So I think we have every system and process and governance arrangement in place to ensure that. I would caveat that with, this is in a hugely volatile world that we are working in. I've been 40 years in the NHS and in health and care, and I have never led or managed in anything like it. So with the caveat of those things that are out with my control, and the fact that this is not a straightforward journey, I do think we've got the diligence and the framework in place to do the best we can. And that will always be to try and have high quality and efficiency throughout our organisation and to be high performing. But we can probably only do that and ensure that in terms of how we get on with our transformation agenda, how we get on with our strategy, and that's all work in progress at the moment. But I think we are a strong organisation with some real innovators, some real good leadership, and a changing organisation in terms of how we connect with communities, all of which gives me hope as a leader that I can take us to the right place.
Thank you for that. It's very encouraging, Pamela. Top of that. Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much. We've just got a couple of minutes remaining, and I mentioned at the start Rhoda Grant is joining the committee this morning. So I'm going to ask Rhoda if she's got any final thoughts or questions to put to the panel from NHS Highland. Rhoda.
Thank you, and I'll try and be as quick as I can. At the start of this process, the NRAC settlement was not paid in full to NHS Highland, and I'm wondering if that is the case now. And also about the challenges coming down the road, there's obviously COVID recovery, but there's also taking on maternity services on behalf of Grampian for Murray until Dr Grace is restored. And you talked about the elective centre as well. I'm wondering how you're going to cope with those challenges going forward, and are you receiving the funding you require to deliver for the people of the islands?
I might ask Dave to come in just to say a bit more about the NRAC, but what I will say in brief there is that yeah, we would agree with you, Rhoda, that in terms of the NRAC at the beginning, that wasn't, we weren't in parity, and you'll know that we got a significant uplift to last year in terms of bringing us up to a reasonable level of parity with other boards. And Dave might expand on that after me. In terms of the maternity and the NTC, so the maternity, we're still, so for me, the most important thing is that NHS Highland's maternity strategy is secure and clear and worked up with the mums and families of Highland. And as you know, we've got our own challenges in house with that. And the Murray maternity aspect, I'd be very clear, we cannot do that without the upgrade to our unit and without the revenue costs to enhance the staffing that we would need to be able to do that. It's the quality and the safety agenda that would need to prevail. So we are going through a planning process at the moment and doing the due diligence around what that would look like. So that will come. But I think as a board and as a chief exec, I have been very clear that that is something that we will work through in terms of how and what it will take to do. And we're trying to do that between now and June. And also really consider the concerns of our clinicians and make sure that those red flags are fully explored and we're clear that they aren't barriers, or if they are, why they are. So we are working through that well, but we are absolutely coming at this from a Highland maternity strategy perspective. It has to be, and nobody knows that more than yourself and, you know, the Caithness mums and but our mums across all our far-flung places have got a tricky choice. And the NTC as well. Well, the NTC is funded, the staffing model is funded. I feel our biggest risk is the staffing and being able to attract and retain, and that would take us back into accommodation and onboarding, which we will take ownership of and do everything we can. But that is going to be our biggest challenge, although we are making reasonable progress with that, and the next 3 to 6 months will really tell us how well we do. I don't know if Dave Garden wants to come in and just say anything else about the NRAC.
Certainly happy to. The government commitment for a number of years now has been that boards who are below their target share, so who are getting effectively less than what their target share is, would be maintained within 1% of that share, and we've been below 1% for quite a few years now. And that resulted in a fairly significant uplift in the previous year of about £14 million. And in the year we've just started, an additional £3 million of NRAC parity money was given to us to maintain us at that level. But I think right now we're about 99.5%, I think, of our NRAC share, which is about £3 or £4 million below us.
Thank you. Rhoda, do you have any further questions you want to put?
Oh, that's fine. Thank you, Chair. Thank you for letting me in.
Not at all. Thank you very much indeed. Well, look, that brings to a close this evidence session. And can I take this opportunity then to thank Boyd Robertson for his opening statement especially, which I think was a very useful framing of the session that we've had, to David Garden, Director of Finance, for his input, which I think has been valuable, and particularly to Pam Dudek, the Chief Executive, who has answered fully and comprehensively and candidly the questions that we've put to you. So can I thank you very much indeed for your time this morning. I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Well, can I welcome people back to agenda item 3 of this morning's Public Audit Committee meeting, which is a continuation of our evidence session with the Auditor General and his team on the report into new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides. We are pleased to welcome back the Auditor General, who is joined again this week by Angela Canning and Anthony Clark. I want to again thank you for coming back so quickly to help us keep the momentum going in our scrutiny. You gave an opening statement last week, Auditor General, so I won't ask you to repeat that. And with your forbearance, I'm going to go straight into questions. Rhoda Grant is also joining us again this week remotely, and so again, if Rhoda wants to come in, if you just indicate in the chat room, we will attempt to bring you in on point. I would just like to begin by recapping on a couple of areas from last week and just trying to seek to get a bit more clarity. I mean, in the evidence last week that you gave us, you said that we don't know on what basis ministers agreed to take the risk to place the order for vessels 801 and 802 with Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited on a non-standard contract basis. And I think, Auditor General, you said there is no documentary evidence of how those risks were considered or how they intended to be managed during the running of the contract. And I just would like to ask you to reflect on something which the First Minister said to Parliament on the 24th of March when asked about documentary evidence and so on. And she said, many of the documents that relate to the decision have been in the public domain for some time. They clearly narrate the issue of the lack of a full refund guarantee. They also narrate the mitigations that were put in place to reduce that risk. So I would ask you to give your comments on that view expressed by the First Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Key message 2 in our report, Convener, draws together our overall conclusion in respect of the availability of documentary evidence for this key part of the decision. And we note that there's insufficient documentary evidence to explain why Scottish ministers accepted the risks and were content to approve the contract award in October 2015. It is absolutely the case that there is plenty of evidence, documentary evidence, surrounding the contract, the procurement arrangements, subsequent events that have taken place. What we're pointing to in this conclusion is that final step between CMAL through Transport Scotland, highlighting that there were risks in the award of the contract, that it was non-standard in respect of the inavailability of the full 100% of the builder's refund guarantee, but that the confirmation came back from ministers that they were content to accept those risks and award the contract to Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited. We think there's a missing piece of evidence, convener, about that final important step, about how ministers arrived at that decision to award the overall contract to Ferguson in light of those unusual circumstances.
So that critical piece of evidence doesn't cover in full the ministerial decision to mitigate the risk.
And I think it's perhaps worth commenting, convener, I think since the evidence session last week, the Scottish Government has confirmed that they've been unable to find the relevant documentary evidence upon which they made that important decision.
Yes, I was going to turn to that next. I mean, I think in light of questioning of the First Minister last Friday, a Scottish Government official was reported to have said that a thorough search had been conducted and the documentation could not be located. And that was then confirmed in Parliament on Tuesday by the Minister for Trade, for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, who said that following a thorough search, the documentation could not be located. Can I just turn you to the Public Finance and Accountability Act and Section 24, which I'm reminded is headed up access to documents and information. And so this is a Section 23 report, and the Act is fairly clear that under a Section 23 report, the examiner from Audit Scotland is entitled to A, have access to all reasonable times to any document in the possession or under the control of the body or office holder in question, which the examiner may reasonably require. It appears that document doesn't exist, but it also goes on then to say under section B that the examiner is entitled to require from any person holding or accountable for any such document any assistance, information or explanation which the examiner reasonably thinks necessary. Does that cover information and explanation as to why documents do not exist?
Yeah, that's a reasonable connection, convener, that through our work we request and receive generally all relevant information that in respect of important decisions. And through this process, as you would expect, we've considered a considerable amount of documentary evidence. We note in the report as well the range of witnesses and conversations that we've had during the course of our evidence gathering to complete a picture and understanding of what I think it's fair to say is both a complex and disputed chain of events that we have before us. But nonetheless, it hasn't led us to a place that we've been able to fully piece together that very important final step prior to the award of the contract and ministerial consideration of how they would accept the risks in the final award to Ferguson Marine. I'll maybe just turn to Anthony if there's anything that he wishes to add on that point as part of our oversight of the report.
I just wanted to be clear with the committee that we receive very positive and full cooperation from the Scottish Government when conducting this audit. We've been provided with, as the Auditor General said, significant amounts of information on most of the key events that transpired throughout this very complicated and long chain of activities. It's just this one piece of evidence that we haven't been able to receive from the Scottish Government.
OK, Mr Clark. Well, I'll either address this to you or to the Auditor General. Did you get an explanation as to why that documentary evidence did not exist?
So I think what we understand, convener, is that we were advised that ministers were content to proceed cognizant of the risks that existed. So I'm not sure we're able to confirm that there was documentary evidence in place. I note the government's explanation that they've searched and are unable to locate it, but I think we're unable to in a position to say that whether the document did or didn't exist.
Okay, so we don't know whether they're searching for something which does or does not exist.
I suggest, convener, I think we've probably gone as far as we're able to, and it may be a line of inquiry that the committee wishes to pursue directly with the officials involved.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to now bring in Willie Coffey, who has got quite a number of questions to put this morning. So, Willie, over to you.
Thanks very much, convener. Auditor General, my questions relate to quality standards, the application of quality standards in design and construction and so on. And as you are well aware, and members are well aware, it's a common theme at this committee over many years. I just wanted to start off by asking a question. The Rural Economy Committee, as you know, took around a year, actually, to carry out its inquiry into this matter, and their findings were published in December 2020. There's over 100 pages of their document here, full of commentary, conclusions and recommendations, and that came out, and your report came out in March this year. Just for the record, can you tell us, did you find any substantive new findings in your analysis of the situation compared to what the committee reported on during their inquiry?
So you're right, Mr. Coffey, the Rural Economy conducted extensive review of the circumstances around the procurement, the design arrangement and aspects of the dispute. I think as we touched on in part last week, in designing the scope for our audit, we took a view that in light of the very significant evidence that the Rural Economy Committee had considered and reported on, that our report was better served by picking up largely from the point just at the identification of Ferguson Marine as the preferred bidder. We note in the report, we are not shipbuilding experts, that there is considerable debate and disagreement between the contracting parties about the nature of the contract, progress and delivery of the contract, but that rather our focus would be instead about the process that was followed, some of the use of public money that transpired after the identification of Ferguson Marine as preferred bidder, the use of loan support, what happened after the yard went into administration, and the future for the delivery of ferries. So I think we build on that report from the Rural Economy Committee, and I think there is some new evidence that we've brought to bear, particularly about the decision to award the contract to Ferguson Marine, especially in light of some of the extent of the risks that were highlighted by CMAL to the Scottish Ministers. Happy to elaborate upon that.
Okay. Maybe I could ask about the general application of quality standards, and it is a recurring theme, convener, as we all know, but in this case they apply to the shipbuilding industry, and we've heard over many years at the committee about the importance of thorough planning and design at the outset of any project, whether it be a piece of software or a bridge or a ship or vessels in this case. You said in your report on page 25 that Ferguson started building the vessels before the designs were agreed with CMAL, which led to substantial reworking being required with increased costs and delays and no link to quality standards. Those were the words in your report. Why do you think that was allowed to happen at the outset? Surely nobody would start building something before they knew what they were being asked to build. So in your view, did those types of failures mean that there was little prospect of a successful construction outcome further down the line?
I'm going to ask Anthony to come in a moment, actually, and just perhaps build on some of the evidence of last week, where we explored, I suppose, the nature of risk and risk transfer in the shipbuilding industry, the nature of the contract that is anticipated to for control, if we can use those terms, to reside with the builder as opposed to the purchaser. What that means for milestone payments, their connection with quality arrangements, and how that is perhaps distinct and unusual from what we'd see from other major infrastructure projects that exist in Scotland. It's maybe worth, if Anthony sees fit, to touch on some of the role of CMAL during the build phase and the extent of, as we I think cover quite a lot of detail in the report, of owner observation reports, which are CMAL's views on progress and quality arrangements. But happy to pass to Anthony, Mr. Coffey, to take us through that.
Thank you very much, Audit General. Mr. Coffey, before I turn to that second point, I might just briefly build on the Audit General's response to your earlier question around did we find anything new beyond what REC found in terms of the contract and how it operated. I think it's fair to say that we did conduct our own primary research. We interviewed people and reviewed the document ourselves. But I think it took to a place that was largely confirming what the REC committee had found in its report, in that we identified deficiencies or weaknesses in terms of the scope for the contract to work in the circumstances associated with Hull 801 and 802. In the contract didn't stipulate clearly what would happen in the event of the builder not applying general quality standards. I think that's well known, it's well documented by the REC committee. We also highlighted in our audit report weaknesses in terms of lack of clarity of specification about what was meant by fabrication for the fabrication milestones. And we highlighted that it wasn't clear how fabrication was due to be assessed. And then there are also, I think, questions arising in terms of the absence of clarity around escalation should there be difficulties during the conduct of the build. So hopefully that builds on what the Auditor General said. You asked a question about, is it unusual for people to start building before all of the designs signed off? We heard during the audit that this is not unusual in shipbuilding. It does happen. It does happen that people start building and fabricating in advance of all of the designs being signed off. But that generally happens where you have a standard vessel. And I think, as you know from the REC report and our report, there is a disagreement and perhaps a dispute about the extent to which these vessels were novel or standard vessels. So that does raise, I think, some interesting questions the committee will wish to explore about the sequencing of events there. I think the Auditor General wanted me to touch on the role of CMAL in this and owner observation reports. The report is pretty clear, I think, that the CMAL highlighted a number of concerns during the build phase, which is still ongoing, of these two vessels. But the nature of the contract meant that CMAL had no power, if you like, to intervene or to stop the ongoing fabrication of the ship. That touches, I think, on the nature of the new build contract that's fairly standard in the shipbuilding industry. This becomes more of an issue in the circumstances where there isn't a full builder's refund guarantee and where there is more risk associated with the purchaser. So I think that's quite an important issue in the context of this report and the issues that you may be interested in as a committee.
To that particular issue, in paragraph 50 of your report, Auditor General, you tell us that CMAL could only advise, not require Ferguson to alter its approach to the design and construction. I mean, I've never heard of any quality standard worth its salt where the customer can't instruct the builder to carry out its wishes. So what you got, what emerged from that was something called these owner observation reports that members have probably read about in the various reports. But these are basically change requests in quality management parlance. They're change requests. They're common in any other effective quality standard. But there were 346 of these, according to your report as well. But only half of them were carried out by the time Ferguson went into administration. Was the scale of that particular outcome unusual in your experience? And basically, was that a symptom of failing to agree the designs in advance for this peculiar construction and effectively meaning that everyone paid the price later on in the project?
If I might come in on this one, if that's OK, Convener and Mr. Coffey. We're not really in a position to provide a comparator of the number of ORs that you might see in a build. We don't have a comparator for these two vessels. It would be very difficult to do so. And we're not naval architects. This isn't our core business. I think what we can say is that the way in which the contract was constructed gave limitations in terms of the extent to which CMAL could enforce owner observation reports. And paragraph 63 of the report touches on this. and there appear to be differences of opinion amongst FMEL and CMEL about the reasonableness of some of those OOR requests, which hinged on, I think, or at least influenced by, disagreements about the nature of what the ships or the hulls were meant to be, and ongoing difficulties around the sign-off of the specification. Linked to this, I think, was difficulties around the relationships between FMEL and CMEL, which obviously created difficulties at different points of the build as well, which are touched on in both the REC report and our report as well, Mr. Coffey.
Last question for the moment, convener. It's still on the quality issue that I think is really crucial and goes to the heart of much of this. In paragraph 62 in your report, that you actually mentioned that the quality of the fabrication wasn't acceptable and that vessel parts themselves weren't being built to the correct specification or standards. And in paragraph 130 in the report, Auditor General, you report that Ferguson's had installed 1,400 cables that were too short. And following a survey by the newly appointed turnaround director, all of them are going to have to be replaced, leading to more expense and more delay, since there's over 8,000 remaining cables still to go in. I mean, I simply ask this, who on earth sanctioned the installation of cables that were too short to do a particular job? Why did nobody spot that early on at the outset? And why did it take a new director to come in to suddenly discover that? In your view, Auditor General, does that not point to incompetent management and construction processes from the outset?
I'll maybe address both of those points, Mr. Coffey. I think paragraph 62, what we look to do, and I think recognising the point that Anthony makes, is that the extent to which we're able to pass judgment on the quality or otherwise of shipbuilding is really limited, and for others to do so. We set out in paragraph 62 that CMAL advised the programme steering group of the concerns that it had about quality in respect of both the fabrication and vessel parts not being built to the project, the correct specification or standards. We also go on to say, of course, that FMEL disputes this. That, and again, this is really one of the themes of the overall report, the extent of disagreement, ambiguity, dispute, resultant breakdown in relationships between both the contractor and the purchaser, that has is very clearly part of the narrative of this report. You mentioned paragraph 138 and some of the more recent events where the now former turnaround director highlighted one of the newer quality issues on the ships and the cables, what that will mean for further delays for the completion of the ships and additional cost needed to rectify it. In response to your specific question as who's responsible for that, well, quality was the responsibility of the shipbuilder during the time that they were tasked with running the contract. Clearly, I think, as Anthony's mentioned, that CMAL had a direct oversight and role during the course of construction, and that escalated at various points following the release of additional funding and loan provision. But overall terms, the yard would be responsible for the quality of the work that's undertaken. Anthony wants to say a word or two more.
Did Ferguson's dispute that the cables were too short?
I don't think we know the detail to that, Mr. Coffey, actually.
Could I just come in here? I think the issue with the cables had just been discovered more recently by FMPG, and Parliament was updated on the issue by the new chief executive of FMPG back in March this year. So I think it's just been a kind of recent...
this process that the cables in the boat, the vessel, were too short.
My understanding is, I think, as FMPG have been reviewing the work in the shipyards, this is an event that's more recently come to light.
Okay, thank you, Anthony.
I wonder if I might just briefly step back and talk more broadly about the governance arrangements, because clearly it's the responsibility of the fabricator to fabricate the ship. But there is a broader question, I think, about the overall governance and oversight of the construction of the two hulls. And I think our report's pretty clear that there were weaknesses in the broader project governance arrangements, in that there was the programme steering group that was meant to be providing strategic oversight of the construction, but we highlighted a number of weaknesses in the programme steering group arrangements in terms of the lack of a project initiation document, a lack of updating of risk registers, weaknesses and shortfalls in the quality of information that was presented to the programme steering group. That's a different point from who's responsible for putting the cables in, but I think it does highlight broader issues around the overall management of these two pieces of fabrication.
Lastly, I mean, none of us are experts at building ships, we know that, but can you see, do you recognise, Auditor General, that some of these issues are recurring themes for us at the Audit Committee about proper investment and effort in design at the early stage gives everyone, every project, no matter what it is, a fair chance of success? And if you don't invest that energy at the outset, you're unlikely to be successful at the end of it.
I absolutely do recognise, Mr Coffey, the committee's long-standing interest in the successful delivery of complex infrastructure investment projects. And I absolutely agree too that, you know, effective design agreement with what's in the contract, that there's clarity from both the purchaser and the provider as to what the intended outcome is, one of the key components to ensure successful delivery. I think in this report, we're clear that that is one of the factors, but that there were a number of other set of circumstances that have led us to today's report.
Thanks very much for that for the moment. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you, Willie. I'm going to turn straight away to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. I want to start by going over a point from last week. So if I can just go back over what was said when asking about the decisions to continue with the contract with FMEL and not go back to the tendering process, which was CMAL's preference at that point. So Jill Miller said, Transport Scotland submitted a paper to ministers to say that FMEL was the preferred bidder and that the First Minister would be announcing that at a visit to the yard on the 31st of August 2015. We know that the pre-qualification exercise made it clear that the provision of a 100% refund guarantee was mandatory. And we asked Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government for all documentation relating to the Minister's decision, but we did not receive any. Anthony Clark had said, one would expect the Accountable Officer in Transport Scotland to share their thoughts, ideas, risks and concerns and to make proposals to the Scottish Ministers on which Ministers can reflect and make a formal decision. As the Auditor General has indicated, one would expect that to be recorded and documented. And Mr Boyle, you later said, we do not entirely know whether this is a case of there being no document to support that important decision or of our having asked for one and of it not being provided. So the whole scenario gives great concern over transparency and secrecy issues within the Scottish Government and also the reasons behind why this critical information has not been recorded. So it could appear that after having announced FMEL as the preferred bidder on the 31st of August, the First Minister would not have wanted to announce the very next month that the bid was not valid due to the builder's refund guarantee not being given and that they were going to go back to the tendering process. So I don't think it's not good practice for the concerns of CMAL not to be taken into consideration and to be overruled by Transport Scotland and Scottish ministers. But it's totally unacceptable for the meetings and decisions not to have been recorded. So two questions. Do you think that there were political motives and pressures from the Scottish Government that led to the failings in the process and the continuation with the contract with FMEL? And is this a decision that would have been taken by a minister, cabinet secretary, first minister or the cabinet as a whole? And who would have been responsible and accountable for recording all of the minutes of the meetings and the decisions that came from them?
Morning, Deputy Convener. I perhaps may just draw the committee's attention to the first question that you ask and to Exhibit 2 in the report again, actually, which sets out the various roles and responsibilities of the government parties involved. So draws attention to CalMAC, CMAL, Transport Scotland and the Scottish Ministers. And in particularly in reference, and I think we touched on last week and earlier this morning, the award for ferry assets rests with ministers. So it would be a ministerial decision to award the contract. And I think that reflected in the chain of events from CMAL as the procuring party through to their sponsor division in Transport Scotland, and then ultimately information provided to ministers about how they would accept the risks and ultimately the award of the contract. So we're clear, Deputy Convener, that it is a ministerial decision to award the contract. As we've also touched on, the fact that there's not that final piece of documentary evidence about the overall award and the acceptance of the extent of the risks that CMAL highlighted, most notably the absence of a full 100% builder's refund guarantee, makes us unable to answer your question in a way that you've asked as to which individual minister ultimately took that decision. Like everyone else, we've been aware that there's been speculation and comment about that, but we're not in a we don't have information that allows us to answer that question directly beyond the overall note that it is a ministerial confirmation of the contract award.
Right. So, who would have been responsible and accountable then for recording if the meetings did take place, or who would be responsible for doing that?
Apologies, I forgot to answer that part of your question. The senior civil servants advising ministers would have been responsible. So ultimately, the accountable officer of Transport Scotland at the time would have been responsible for the formal advice, the note, and then the recording of that decision. As you would expect, they would have been supported by other officials who would have been party, but the importance of formal, clear record-keeping really matters in such circumstances, particularly the award of large infrastructure projects, and most notably where this deviates from the standard contract arrangements. It's very clear that ought to have happened, but appears not to have done so as we would have expected.
OK, so Sheila, kind of systemic failure of the government to record crucial information. So, see, since the publication of your report, are you aware of any directive or actions taken by the Scottish Government to ensure that all ministers and civil servants ensure that minutes and evidence of meetings are recorded?
I'll ask the team to come involved and if they are aware of anything. I'm not, but I'm not aware of any further directive from senior officials, permanent secretary, in respect of the quality of record keeping or the importance of it. That's not to say that that's not been happening or that there hasn't been internal communication within the Scottish Government to that effect. Deputy Convener, it may be a line of inquiry the committee wishes to pursue with the government, but I'll just check with colleagues if they know.
Just to say, we're not aware of any particular instructions following the audit report, but we are aware that when issues like this have occurred in the past, have been instructions issued by the appropriate Perm Secretary to their staff.
OK, thanks. And just one in ministerial direction. The accountable officer writes to the appropriate Cabinet Secretary expressing their concerns, seeking direction. In response, the ministerial direction instructs the accountable officer to implement the decision. As a result of this direction, the Minister, not the accountable officer, is now accountable for the decision. So no directions have been made in relation to the new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides, or none have been recorded. So I think it would be fair to assume that with a decision of this importance, there would have been ministerial direction for the contract to have proceeded. So if this paperwork cannot be found, or indeed does not exist, does the accountability lie with the accountable officer or the minister?
Yes, Deputy Convener, in the absence of a formal, apologies for the distinction, but written authority in terms of the Scottish Public Finance Manual in Scotland as opposed to the terminology ministerial direction, if an accountable officer doesn't request such written authority, then the accountability for the decision rests with the accountable officer.
Okay, thank you. And touching on something that Mr. Coffey had mentioned, CMAL issued a design and build contract in November, 1 month after the Minister said the contract was to proceed, £24.2 million, which was 24.9%, so just under a quarter of the total contract value, was given for procurement deposits. The following month in December, £2.8 million was given for cutting of steel. On page 25, the key message 2 states that FMEL began vessel construction before it had agreed the detailed design with CMAL. So is it normal procedure to start building a vessel before a finalised drawing has been signed off? And who would have authorised the payments to start being given to FMEL before this had been completed?
I'll ask Anthony to come in and say a bit more about the contract award arrangements, just about the extent to which, building, I suppose, on some of last week's discussion as well about project milestones, the size or the number of project milestones in this contract, and the extent to which they weren't related to vessel progress or quality arrangements. And Anthony can also just touch on, or contradict me if he knows otherwise, if it wasn't CMAL that were in a as the body responsible for authorising these payments. Anthony.
I think the Audit General is correct that it would have been CMAL that offered advice on the appropriateness or otherwise of making those payments. But you might remember from the previous session, Ms Downey, that Jill Miller explained that there were particular circumstances at the start of the project, in that there was a decision reached, I think, that early payments should be made to purchase material, given some of the known cost pressures associated with the building of the ship. So there were particular circumstances at play around that early payment, I think, that can perhaps explain why that payment was made. But again, it might be something you want to follow up yourselves as a committee. Just to touch briefly as well on your question around, is it unusual for fabrication to start quite so quickly? I said in response to Mr. Coffey earlier that it's not unusual for someone to start fabricating before all of the vessel design has been approved and signed off. That places the risk of fabrication on the fabricator, but in the circumstances of a lack of full builder's refund guarantee, that could be seen as being problematic.
In paragraph 102, the turnaround report indicated that it would cost between £110.3 million and £114.3 million to complete the vessels, and that's on top of the £83.25 million CMAL had already paid to FMEL. That's more than the original cost. Was any scrutiny done to see how those figures were reached?
So I'll ask Angela to come in a second, just to say a bit more about the new arrangements in the yard, the new public body that is overseeing the delivery of the contracts, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. But it is our understanding that these are figures that the turnaround director and their team arrived at following their assessment of the current state of completion of the vessels, the ongoing challenges to rectify some of the circumstances that Mr. Coffey referred to with the cables, what that meant for the delay in the completion of the two ships. In more general terms, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow is subject to public audit arrangements as distinct from the arrangements that were in place while Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited was a private organisation. And that affords both myself and ultimately this committee and the Parliament more opportunity for scrutiny of the yard's arrangements and public reporting of the progress towards completion. I'll ask Angela to say a bit more if she wishes.
I don't think I've got much more to. I've not got anything to add to what the Auditor General said.
The only thing I might briefly add is to draw your attention, Ms. Downey, to paragraph 99 of the report, where we highlight that whilst the Scottish Government had undertaken some due diligence in advance of nationalising the yard and was able to draw on the turnaround director's report, they didn't have the opportunity to gain a detailed understanding of the kind of operational challenges in the shipyard. So they weren't able to look at the level of outstanding work. So I just thought it's worth bringing that particular point of the report to your attention, Ms. Downing, because I think it's relevant to your question.
Thanks. And just in the last one, it's a long question again. So former FML management are critical of the report produced by the turnaround director following nationalisation of the Ferguson Marine Shipyard. How would you characterise the report and the process by which it was compiled?
I think we're limited in our ability to form an assessment of the turnaround director's report. We know that the turnaround director's judgment was informed by the work of him and his team about what he found in the yard. We also know that there were considerable changes of management at the yard very shortly after the body went into administration and became a public body. So there was a lack of continuity of senior officials in the yard. Anthony's right in saying that the Scottish Government weren't in a place to have a rounded picture of the risks, issues, financial implications that they were taking on when they nationalised the yard. But beyond that, we haven't undertaken any a scrutiny per se of the costs that have been included in the turnaround director's report. We've no reason to doubt them, Deputy Convener. And I think it is clearly the case that, given the state of completion of both ships, that there remains many months of additional work and public expenditure in order to complete them.
One of the comments was that Audit Scotland did not consider vessel design or the initial tendering process, which FML argue is essential to understanding subsequent delays and cost increases. What would be your response to that?
I would reiterate that the scope of our report didn't consider vessel design, and we took a view that, you know, that had been well considered by the Rural Economy Committee's report. And building on the fact that, as we also note in the report and as was heard in evidence by the Rural Economy Committee, that the extent of dispute and disagreement was clear, that both sides sought independent experts to support their position on the design, whether it was a prototype or not, whether the contract suggested as much. So, and as we have mentioned more than once or twice, we are not shipbuilding experts, and therefore took a view that the design arrangements had been covered and reported on, and that there is clear dispute about it, that therefore the scope of our work was better served looking at other areas of the nature of the delivery of these two ships.
Right, thank you very much. Just very briefly, you mentioned the turnaround director there, and I just wonder whether, as the Auditor General, you've got any comment or view on the contractual arrangements of the turnaround director and the terms of his engagement, which I don't think is included in your report, but I wonder whether you've had a chance to reflect on that.
You're right, Convener, we haven't included that in the scope of our report. I would just note that if you're referring to the rates of pay for the turnaround director, that these are unusual in a public sector context and considerably beyond what we see of other public sector leaders. I note that this was commented on by the Scottish Government, that this was consistent with the market rate for such services. I have no benchmark one way or the other, Convener, whether that is the case or not. As you say, we haven't done any additional work on it.
Thank you. That may be a line of inquiry we'll pursue elsewhere in that case. Thank you. I'm going to now invite Craig Hoy to put forward a series of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Boyle. Mr. Boyle, last week you expressed your frustration that you can't get to the full facts and the heart of the Ferrygate scandal, and barely a week into our inquiries, I think that some members of this committee will share that frustration, because key documents can't be found or weren't prepared, key witnesses have been gagged, there are reports of possible fraud and corruption, Scotland's former First Minister has gone as far as saying we should be calling in the cops, and today Eric Ostergaard, the chairman of the government's Ferries Quangle when the deal was done, has said that CMAL was given written confirmation
to proceed awarding the contract to Ferguson Marine, but was not given any written confirmation as to why this is the case. And just like all scandals, there is now perhaps some whiff of a cover-up of people or possibly even government ministers covering their tracks. So 1 week into our inquiries, I do share your sense of frustration, but we're not alone, because in his submission, Jim McCall, who, let's not forget, was once a pal of the SNP, the First Minister on speed dial, and one of their favourite Scottish businessmen, is clearly frustrated. And his submission to this committee is stark, and it points to more than just a fallout amongst friends in the nationalist movement. He says that the procurement process was driven by party political dynamic. He says that it was rushed to deliver headlines for the SNP conference. He says that CMAL's concerns were not conveyed to him, and that he says not enough time was given to feasibility of the conceptual design. And if this was the case, then it would be very serious indeed. We'd be talking here about a corruption of the procurement process, and it would explain why things since then went badly wrong, and why potentially ministers have been keen to cover their tracks. So in the absence of any documentary evidence that disproves this, how concerned should we be that the original process may have been conducted along these lines? And if Mr. McCall's claims are true, would this not explain why we've seen such resistance to full and total transparency at a critical point in this process?
Good morning, Mr. Hoy. I think clearly there is much comment on this report and the committee's evidence, consideration of evidence on it. In respect of the procurement arrangements, firstly, I'm at risk of repeating, I think, my frustration and noting again the absence of key documentation with which ministers accepted the heightened risk given the absence of a builder's refund guarantee and how they would bear such risks. And given, as we've touched on, I think, last week, that typically in the shipbuilding industry, the risk is transferred to the builder. The purchaser is protected by the 100% builder's refund guarantee. The absence of written confirmation as to how those risks would be managed is clearly a significant factor in this report. It's probably kind of limited as to how much more I would wish to comment on the extent of political factors. I think, other than perhaps repeating the answer I gave to the deputy convener, that in respect of the respective roles and responsibilities for the contract award, that the Scottish ministers had a very clear role in the contract award. What I'm not in a place to do is to comment upon the motivations for that decision.
And I don't want to dwell on the original procurement process, because I recognise that was a matter for the Rural Affairs Committee, and that your report does not go into this, although I think Parliament still has questions to ask and answers should be forthcoming, because there's still something suspect about the scoring and emphasis in the tendering matrix process. But in relation to tendering and procurement, there are three critical dates and points in the development of these vessels which your report does cover, and where that could be revisited. These are the moments where the government could have got a grip, it could have stemmed the spending, and it could have then made sure that these ships were procured properly. But for whatever reason, and possibly to keep covering its tracks, the government did not go down that route. And the first of these three points or moments comes when Ferguson Marine suddenly announces it cannot offer a full 100% builder's refund guarantee. And in the interests of transparency and fairness, which are critical to any procurement process, should the government not at that stage, through CMAL, have reopened the tendering process to the other five bidders, or at least informed them that the playing field had changed significantly? And do you know if this was considered, or whether other bidders were informed at that stage of this material change to the procurement contract?
I'll bring colleagues in a second, just about the chain of events, which we set out in a bit of detail in the report about the negotiations, the timing that it came to light that Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited weren't able to offer the 100% builder's refund guarantee and the actions that CMAL took thereafter. If I may reflect on some of last week's evidence as well, I think my colleague Jill Miller was asked on a similar theme about whether or not Ferguson had been had raised any reservations or concerns about the 100% builder's refund guarantee prior to the identification of their status as preferred bidder. And Jill confirmed that that wasn't the case. So therefore, by implication, a tacit acceptance of the terms and conditions of the contract. Before turning to Anthony, I think it would have been reasonable for CMAL to say, well, in the absence of the provision of the full terms and conditions of the contract, as you would expect, really, in other public procurement arrangements, if a provider cannot meet the terms and conditions of the contract, that's a material event and would give the purchaser the opportunity to take a decision as to either how they would manage those risks or whether they would restart the arrangements. But I'll pass to Anthony, I think, if he wishes to say anything further.
I think we're centering around a point that's been covered a few times already this morning, which is this critical decision around the decision to appoint or not appoint FMEL to this contract in the circumstances where the builder's refund guarantee wasn't available. What we know, I think, and what we've set out very clearly in the report, Mr. Hoy, is that CMAL highlighted their concerns about this risk with Transport Scotland. We also know that Transport Scotland highlighted to Scottish ministers CMAL's preference to restart the tendering process, but the decision was made not to go down that route. What we don't know is on what basis it was decided not to follow the advice or the concerns or address the concerns of CMAL. That's not known at this point.
Okay, so let's maybe bypass some of what then happened and head or fast forward to June 2018. It's reported in Annex B that FMEL asked the Scottish Government to intervene to instruct CMAL to take part in an expert determination process to resolve the growing dispute between the procurement agency and the yard. FMEL managers say that CMAL did not do this because CMAL had something over ministers, that they had forced CMAL to do the deal with Ferguson Marine in the first place. So reflecting on your report's account of this period, FMEL's management says that you have accepted the government's, and I use quotes, false narrative and fabulous propaganda, that the fact that this was supposedly down to FMEL and not down to flaws flowing from the procurement and design process being rushed because ministers wanted McCall's yard and they wanted it quickly. Mr. McCall goes on to say in his submission that the reasons for the government not intervening to agree to an expert determination process is because it would be very damaging to the government because CMAL's board had threatened to resign en masse and blow the lid off what really happened in relation to the awarding of the contract. Have you seen any evidence of this? And rather than going down the route of an EDP, would that not have been another point where they could have revisited the procurement and delivery of these ferries?
Yeah, before turning specifically to your point, we considered a considerable suite of evidence in arriving at the judgment we set out in our report. And as it's clear from the report and indeed the subsequent evidence that the committee said, there is such conflicting events or interpretation of events, and that continues in the submissions that the committee have subsequently received. If I may, I suppose, pick up the point you make about the extent of the dispute and the options available to resolve disputes between the contracting parties. You mentioned dispute resolution, expert determination, and what happened in these circumstances was really the step beforehand about mediation as to whether that would be agreed. And draft mediation between the parties was progressed, but we note in the report that there was a failure to agree a terms of reference and an extent thereafter, an escalation to the government parties suggesting to Ferguson that it needed to pursue its claim through the court of session. That ultimately was deemed by Ferguson to be unaffordable, and the scale of the dispute by that stock, many tens of millions of pounds, going to the court of session, as Ferguson have set out, would have led to work stopping on the yard and redundancies and job losses and so forth. What feels like a missed opportunity, Mr. Hoy, is that there wasn't mediation pursued in this contract that might have led to a better outcome. Because ultimately, we are still in circumstances where the ships aren't complete, rural communities relying on the boats, many years late, and the use of mediation might have provided a better, cheaper and quicker alternative to the circumstances that we set out in the report.
Right. And just two quick questions just in conclusion. There's one final point, obviously, where the procurement process could have been reopened or where a different decision is taken, and that's at the point where the government determined that it would nationalise the yard. And in your report, you say that the decision to nationalise was taken, quotes, without full and detailed understanding on the amount of work required to complete the vessels, the likely costs or the significant operational challenges at the shipyard. So again, here we see the government pressing on regardless. How concerned are you that the government proceeded with nationalisation on this basis? And what were the consequences, both financially and in terms of the ongoing construction of the vessels?
You're right, you do. You have set out one of the judgments that we make in the report, that the decision to nationalise the yard was taken without full sight of the anticipated costs necessary to complete the vessel. Vessels, plural, I should say. I say that is consistent. The overriding aim of the government was clear, though, is to progress with the completion of the yard, save the yard, and to protect jobs in Ferguson Marine. So there is a consistency of the government's intention in nationalising the yard. But given the scale of the additional costs and time necessary to complete the boats that are set out in the turnaround director's report, there's a question there for government as to whether it could have been had a fuller understanding of the obligations that it was assuming at the point that it nationalised the yard.
And just finally, in relation to my final question, last week you said that one material witness from FML who wanted to give evidence to your audit and investigation process could not do so because they'd signed a gagging order with the Scottish Government. If the Scottish Government agreed to lift these non-disclosure agreements, would you be willing to reopen your lines of inquiry and produce an annex to this report?
It's certainly something we could consider, whether there's any material additional evidence. And it's not to say that we would reopen our report, but we would clearly look to exercise the opportunity to speak to the person if that was an opportunity. I think we understand the circumstances as to why that wasn't the case. It wasn't necessarily just the government, but also the administrators of the yard who weren't willing or able to be in a position to waive the non-disclosure agreement that the former manager of Ferguson's had signed.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Just on that final point about the contract arrangements post-nationalisation, I mean, one of the things that you highlight in paragraph 105 of the report is quite a fundamental shift from the contract being based on a fixed price tender basis to a cost plus basis. And I think that you say that the Scottish Government agreed to paying additional vessel costs regardless of the final price. Do you have a view on that decision?
It's clearly unusual, Convener. You know, I think it reflects the circumstances that the Scottish Government has found itself in, with it determining that there's a necessity to complete the outstanding vessels. I think we also note in the report that the government's view was that this was the cheapest and best option for them, as opposed to undertaking something more fundamental. As we also, I think, refer to at various points, there was consideration about scrapping the contract, towing the boats to other yards and exercising those options. So cost plus, yes, that's unusual and quite distinct from the fixed price and the very clear fixed price nature that led to so many of the decision points in this process. But beyond that, I think it's perhaps reflects the extent of additional risk that the government has assumed in continuing to meet the costs of these two ships.
And just on a point related to that, a couple of paragraphs later on in the report, paragraph 108, inform us that CMAL, who is the purchaser, also became the technical consultant. Doesn't that blur lines and even potentially represent a conflict of interest?
The arrangements are unusual. There is no denying that, convener. I think the paragraph also notes that Transport Scotland no longer has a role in the delivery of the ships, and that's quite distinct from where we were. The accountability of the governance arrangements have clearly changed following the nationalisation of the yard. As we mentioned, the creation of a new public body, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, following the nationalisation, the consultancy arrangements of CMAL and the government's role more directly themselves. As to the extent to which it's a conflict of interest, roles and responsibilities have to be clearly defined, especially as they have evolved, as they've been set out here. The technical consultant nature of CMAL's role is maybe something Angela might want to talk about, just in terms of how all that's operating and some of the safeguards that are in place.
Yeah, obviously CMAL, because of their involvement throughout the project and because of their expertise around like the shipbuilding area, I think that's obviously why they've been selected as the technical consultants FMPG to support the government around that. So they're still heavily involved in reviewing what's going on at the shipyard. They have an on-site presence at the shipyard just now, and are, as we've discussed before, they'll raise owner observation reports and discuss issues with shipbuilding staff on an ongoing basis as well.
Okay, but I mean, we've heard this morning about how people have applied to court to get settlements in disputes about payments. We've heard about mediation mechanisms being looked at and then abandoned. CMAL looking at a new environment where it's a cost-plus arrangement, and a lot of those disputes have been around, and if you read evidence submitted to this committee by Jim McCall, it's a lot of that is about... you're looking at this through the wrong end of the telescope. Unfair demands were being placed on us, and that's why the costs ended up where they ended up, and why the delays ended up where they ended up. And that's all because of CMAL. And now CMAL are the technical consultant in this environment where it's a cost plus. So, I mean, how do we know, looking out for the public's money, how do we know that isn't a blank check to CMAL to get the highest spec, the technical corrections that will cost an inordinate amount of money, upon which there is no limit?
So I'd be very clear, convener. I'm sure the committee will want to be assured that that isn't the case, that there isn't a bottomless pool of resource available to complete these two vessels. It's undoubtedly the case that many tens of millions remain to be spent on them, as set out in both the turnaround director's report and the new chief executive's report. But I think perhaps with some confidence, as set out by the new chief executive, that the timeline for the completion of the vessels is noted, that there needs to be rigorous project management, monitoring in place, deadlines in a way that is distinct from some of the arrangements that we set out in the report. I'm sure the committee will want to be assured, and that may inform where you wish to go next.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to now bring in Colin Beattie. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, I'd like to focus on two different areas, partly based on some of the comments you made last week. Some of the points probably are parts that fellow members have brought up, but I'd like to just get in my own mind the sequence here and get it right, because it is a bit complicated. CMAL themselves awarded the contract to build the ferries. They were the ones that signed off on it. There was no ministerial direction. I mean, jump in if I'm telling porkies here, I'm trying to get this right. There was no ministerial direction to do so. So there would be no piece of paper for that, correct?
You're correct, Mr. Beattie. There was no ministerial direction or written authority requested from civil servant accountable officers of ministers. I would say that there is a slight distinction that's also relevant, of course, that ministers were responsible for awarding the approval of the contract.
Yeah, I'm coming to that in due sequence, hopefully. So CMAL awarded the contract in its capacity as the procuring authority. They did express concerns about the absence of the full refund guarantee. Now, they themselves put in place mitigations in regard to that. There's a question about the timing on this, because FML didn't say anything about not being able to comply with the terms of the tender until after the announcement was made, which in itself is a bit odd, because you would have thought at the time of responding to the tender document, you would have said, no, I can't comply with these bits.
So I think we've covered that in slightly in part with discussion, Mr. Hoy, and also John Miller's response of last week, that Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited's concerns about the requirements to offer 100% builder's refund guarantee, is our understanding, were noted post their identification as the preferred bidder for the contract.
Actual announcement. Now, I'm looking at documents that have been in the public domain for a very long time now, and this is the document addressed on the 8th of October 2015 to the ministers. And I'd like to quote just three parts from that, which I think are quite important. This is the communication to the ministers asking for their confirmation that they are satisfied, or they support the bid. And I'd quote from it: procurement risk can rarely be removed entirely in complex contracts, and CMAL have addressed this, taking their own legal advice, and in particular by agreeing contractual terms with FML, which are broadly comparable with the tender specification. And again, in case of a challenge, CMAL would robustly defend their position on the basis of the legal advice they've received and the steps they have taken to bring the final contract clauses into broad comparability with the tender specification. But I think it's quite an important point. And the last part I would like to quote is, discussions between Transport Scotland officials and CMAL senior executives on Tuesday the 29th September and Friday the 2nd of October, the CMAL senior executives made clear that CMAL would likely be facing similar problems no matter who the preferred tenderer was. Their senior executives also made the point that despite receiving stronger financial assurances in previous shipbuilding contracts, they still subsequently faced problems and in one instance significant challenges during the respective construction phase. Now, if I was a Scottish minister receiving that, I would say, OK, they put in place mitigation, which is broadly in, you know, covering the contractual tender that went out. Would it be reasonable to give the nod on that? I mean, nobody's denying they did give the nod, but wouldn't it be reasonable to take that into account?
So I think what you've just read out suggests some ambiguity and perhaps distinct from, I think, what we set out in our report. I'm not sure we would arrive at the same conclusion that a 25% builder's refund guarantee plus some of the additional safeguards is broadly comparable with 100%.
I'm looking at what the ministers are receiving. They're being told it's broadly comparable with the tender specification. Would they have a reason to challenge that?
I'm going to bring Anthony in a wee second. I think he wants to highlight a section of the report as well. But I think that the advice that they've received, and forgive me, I don't have that in front of me at the moment, but I would say is that, I think, just to repeat, our judgment is that isn't broadly comparable. We see that the nature of the shipbuilding contract, as distinct from some of the other large public procurement contracts that inevitably considered by ministers more routinely, relies upon the 100% builder's refund guarantee to secure the transfer of risk. If you allow me to pause for a second, Mr. Beattie, I think I want to bring Anthony
looking
just a
second. Detail more. That's been put in the report and so on, mm-hmm. We might sit around this table and agree, but I mean, the ministers are only receiving these few papers on which they're basing their decision.
And Sorry, Anthony, and it may be that's an area that the committee wishes to explore in detail with some other organisations, but I think in terms of our response, Anthony, we want to say a bit more.
I just thought it's worth drawing out other aspects of this email that you're referring to, Mr. Beattie. Annex B of the email contains Eric Ostergaard's email of 26th of September that's referred to in the note, in which he states that if FML don't get back with substantially improved conditions in this respect, the board of CML have no option other than to again reject the deal. This will imply shelving the project until further notice or reopening the contract negotiations with another of the bidders. So there are different bits in the information that was provided with ministers offering differing views. The question you asked around legal challenge, which you referred to, you're quite right to say that CML were clear that they would be able to defend the contract were it to be let. That doesn't mean that they were saying they wanted it to be let, which is a slightly different point.
I mean, there is no doubt, looking at the documentation, that ministers did give approval in some way. What's missing is the piece of paper that says they did it. That's basically what's missing. But I don't think anybody's disputing that approval was given. At least that's what I would interpret from these documents. What I would say is, if I was the minister seeing this coming forward, I'd kind of be reassured in giving that decision that there was some sort of comparability with the tender specification, because that's what the covering document says.
If I may, I'd perhaps refer back to my evidence of last week, I think discussion with the convener, that the extent of concern from CMAL and that how they communicated that to Transport Scotland, I think we would typically have expected that if the concern was as such, that would have resulted in a request for written authority. But as we know, that was absent as part of this process.
But given, I mean, CMAL, did CMAL actually give a formal document with detailed concerns which got to the Scottish Minister? I mean, I'm not sure. I'm asking you.
The document you're referring to, Mr. Beattie, which I think I have in front of me as well, which is the email that went from Richard Hadfield to a number of ministers and others, contains as Annex B, the concerns that CMAL were raising at this point of the process.
Yeah, but if you look at the annex and then you look at the actual covering document that goes to the ministers asking for their confirmation, it doesn't seem to match up in terms of concerns.
I can't comment on the content of the advice which Transport Scotland gave to ministers. I can merely refer to the fact that Annex B does highlight CMAL's concerns.
Well, looking at the email that went to the ministers, which did, yes, contain these annexes, if I was a minister reading the covering email in which I'm asked to give a confirmation that I'm content with this, I would look at the clear indication here, broadly comparable with the tender specification, and an assurance that previous financial assurances with previous shipbuilding contracts subsequently faced problems and so forth. I would say, yeah, they seem to have done a decent job there in mitigating the risk.
The thing I think we would probably just reassert the judgment that we reached. There seems to be a mismatch in the strength of feeling that CMAL had about the scale of risk, the difference from the standard terms and conditions, given the absence of the builder's refund guarantee, and then how that flowed through in communication to ministers. That is also an issue of real concern, Mr. Beattie, that the transparency and the scale of concern that ought to have been shared, if that's somehow been phrased in a way that suggests ambiguity, because, apologies for at risk of repeating myself, I think we've clearly reached the view that the extent of risk and the management of that through 25% builder's refund guarantee and other arrangements isn't broadly comparable with a full 100% builder's refund guarantee.
And on the face of it, I would agree. But as you say, there is ambiguity here. And as I say, if I was a Scottish minister receiving this covering email, I would just look at the bit that says broadly comparable with tender specifications and so on and say, right, they seem to have done their job. Anyway, that's probably for a different discussion going forward. So looking again at... Just a few minutes left. I thought it was okay till 12. looking at FMEL, one of the concerns I raised last week was about the destination of the money and what happened to the money. We can sort of speculate that the £45 million, which was there really for working capital, if you like, paying salaries and keeping the yard ticking over, were used for that purpose. But tens of millions of pounds went into that yard, and there's no evidence at the point of nationalisation that there was that value of work or equipment lying there. So the question is, what happened to that? Now, you've said that because it's a private company, Audit Scotland has been unable to carry out a proper due diligence on that. Now that it's nationalised, do we own that history, and can we retrospectively look at what happened to that money? Because there must be records someplace.
Angela can say a bit more about the transfer of entities or, you know, what happens, but I think it is the case that these are separate legal entities. So Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited entered administration and subsequent liquidation. Some of the transfer of assets happened through the Scottish Government's security arrangements that it had in place for the provision of the loans as it became a secured creditor, and sought to purchase the assets from the administrators of FMEL. FMEL's accounts are public record, Mr. Beattie, so, you know, and as are Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited Holdings, I think, as the group company. So they both report progress of vessels 801 and 802 whilst they were in construction. So there is something of a public record, and they were subject to external audit, as private companies are. But that isn't the same as us having a complete and full record of a private sector organisation's company accounts and the transactions that flowed thereafter. Before asking Angela just to say a bit more about what transpired, I think it also brings us back to some of our earlier conversation about what assurances CMAL had about the progress of the vessels, the payments that they were making, what they were making payment for. And one of the overall conclusions we make in the report is that the milestone payments weren't linked sufficiently to either quality or progress of the vessels. And before turning to Angela, you also mentioned the loans as well. The first loan was in respect of financial support to Ferguson that was designed to support its working capital, payment of invoices and so forth. The second loan for £30 million was anticipated to be more closely linked to quality and progress, but we also set out in the report our judgment is that that wasn't sufficiently clear when the loan drawdown was made available. I'll pause, Mr. Beattie, because I'm sure Angela wants to say a bit more.
Yeah, I've not got much more to add, Mr. Beattie, but you mentioned the millions of pounds that had gone to FMEL as part of the contractual payments. We refer to that in paragraph 147 of the report. And we know from information that CMAL provided to the REC committee that £62.5 million of that had been spent on materials and equipment, and just over £13 million on labour. So that's the information that we have about the kind of high-level areas of spending from FMEL.
But at the point that the yard was nationalised, the assets in the yard must have been valued. Were they comparable to the money that came in to produce these assets?
I think it's safe to say no, they weren't. Now, if you look at the... I'll make sure I'm quoting the right figure, but I think it's in the region of £6 million was the figure that the government was able to secure by virtue of the administration. So there is that doesn't reflect the extent of payments. I should say, however, that I hesitate in making a definitive judgment around that, given that, you know, we're not cited on the valuation process of a work-in-progress vessel that might have a different valuation as it becomes a working asset. So, again, it's not an area that we have explored in any great detail.
Isn't this an area that should be very important for us to look at? I mean, for this committee, one of the key things we look at is following the public pound. Here we have a situation where tens of millions of pounds have been poured into a project, and at the end of it, there's not that much to show, value-wise.
I, th- I think ultimately this will, I think, speaks to the point where we conclude our report, and as I mentioned last week, the need for a fuller and next stage review as to what has been delivered, both in terms of the scale of public spending for these vessels, the need for an understanding of the vast sums of public money, what's been produced, and therefore, and what safeguards are genuinely in place to avoid a repeat, whether it's in ferries or others. But it is the case, Mr. Beattie, that tens of millions of pounds have been spent, tens of millions of pounds still need to be spent on these vessels in order to get them to be working assets.
Is this a review that you're considering doing?
I think we'll perhaps await the finalisation of this committee's evidence to inform where we go next, or whether there are other parties who will be taking up the next stage, but it's very clearly part of our forward thinking.
It seemed to me there was an awful lot of evidence in the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee report that I would have hoped might have led you down that road without waiting for the Public Audit Committee to come out.
I think, as we've said on a number of occasions, I think we're satisfied with the scope of our work. Sets out at a point in time where we are now that these are the two vessels that are very much work in progress. Many millions of pounds have been spent to unsatisfactory progress. We have said in evidence that the Rural Economy Committee considered a range of different views, dispute, supported by independent experts, and took a clear view about the scope of our report.
Do we have time for accountable officers and governance and all those other things?
I'm sure after discussion we'll reach that point. I do want to, and thanks Colin, I do want to, in the remaining few minutes, give an opportunity for Rhoda Grant to ask questions, who's joining us remotely and is of course an MSP for the Highlands and Islands. Who will hopefully be served by these ferries if they eventually set sail. Rhoda.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just ask a question? Obviously, there's no paper trail here, but when you were doing your investigation, did you ask the accountable officer who at ministerial level told them to proceed?
I'm not sure we're in a position to answer that today, Ms. Grant. We may need to come back to the committee in writing. As you probably observe, as our colleague who had some of those direct discussions is not with us today. We had, rest assured, extensive discussions with officials. We set out in the report the various people that we interviewed as part of the primary evidence gathering sessions. But in respect of which ministerial minister took that decision, again, we're referring collectively that it was a ministerial decision. So we're not cited today, and I suspect not cited entirely as to which minister took that call.
Okay, so you wouldn't have asked the accountable officer just directly if they recalled who'd made that decision to them?
So I can commit to coming back to the committee in writing if we have that information.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Can I just maybe ask a couple of questions about procurement? Because it seems to me that the whole process of procurement was wrong. But we've also heard in the news recently that the Scottish Government are procuring ferries from Turkey, and as are Norway. But Norway are only paying half the price for comparable ferries. And I just wonder if there is something that is very wrong with the Scottish Government's procurement process that leads to them paying huge amounts of money for ferries and maybe not procuring them in a way, because obviously those ferries that we're talking about now haven't been delivered. We've yet to see if the others will be delivered.
There's probably little that we can really say. We haven't done any audit work on ferry procurement arrangements in the round. I suspect that's a question probably for CMAL to assure the Parliament about the overall value for money arrangements that it has relative to other countries if it uses those as a benchmark. other than to just acknowledge the point that we are equally cited as some of the recent press coverage about the relative costs that the Scottish Government is incurring compared to other countries as part of its fairly procurement arrangements. But beyond that, Ms Grant, we don't have any further detailed information.
Okay. Would that be something you would look into in the future, given it is about public spending and the costs to the public purse?
Yeah, something we're happy to consider. I think it's where we go next with ferries. This is our second piece of work on ferries following an early report 3 or 4 years ago on overall ferry arrangements. We also are awaiting the government's final decision on ferry governance arrangements in Scotland and how that will shape up. And we'll use that also to inform our future work programme.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Rhoda. Well, that brings us up to the end of the time that we've got this morning. So can I take this opportunity to once again thank you, Auditor General, for your willingness to answer the wide range of questions that we've put to you this morning, and to the team that's joined you, Anthony Clark and Angela Canning. We very much appreciate your input too, which has been illuminating. We will, of course, have to consider what our next steps are, and I think you've given us some suggestions on where it might be useful for us to look further, and we will reflect on those, and as a committee we will reach our own conclusions on the next steps forward for us. But thank you again for your evidence this morning, and I now wish to move the committee into private session.